goes live in 3 minutes. Welcome to Lynn Cullen Live at pghcitypaper.com. Email your questions and comments to Lynn at pghcitypaper.com.
Hey, how you doing? Welcome to the program. I'm Lynn Cullen. I'm just saying that to remind myself because I'm a little bit fluttery. You know how you do the same thing every day, and then today, of course, it didn't play out like it's supposed to. So all it takes is one little wrinkle. I'm not complaining. Life is good. I got a bunch of stuff here, none of it related to anything in particular. If there's something you guys want to talk, I mean, I know there's some big stories going on, and I have been remiss in talking about them. And, Homeland Security funding, what's another big story that's going on? Net neutrality. What else? When it comes to Washington, I'm pretty much can't go there anymore. I just can't. One reaches a point. And it's not that I wouldn't, I don't mean to spread the cynicism, but, jeez. Okay. So now the Brits are getting on Bill O'Reilly. Glad to see it. The Guardian has been digging around, and what's turning out to be the case is he's every bit like Brian Williams, if not more so. He is a confabulator, an embellisher, a person who has the need to make himself appear to be more heroic than he in fact is. So now we know about his lying about being in a war zone. He was not. Now we know about his lying about he has said on more than one occasions, I saw nuns killed in El Salvador. Bullets, back of their head. No, he didn't. He saw pictures. So I guess technically, and now he's saying that's his defense. No, I saw pictures. I was shown pictures when I was in El Salvador of nuns being slaughtered. And so when I said I saw nuns being slaughtered, hey, is that true or not? Well, if that's the case, then I saw, think of what I saw. Oh, geez, I have seen such things you cannot imagine. I saw those brave American soldiers put that flag up on Iwo Jima. I saw the atom bomb go off over Hiroshima. Oh, what I've seen. It's amazing that I don't have PTSD. It really, really, really is. So, and now he's apparently, he's mum on the next little thing that's been trotted out. He was a reporter for Inside Edition. His career, his journalistic career, I mean, in terms of like serious journalism, has been a total downward spiral. He started at CBS News, which at the time had a reputation, a good one. And then he goes into Inside Edition, making a lot more money, I assure you, pretending to be a reporter. And then from there to Fox. Well, so it says here that he is paid $20 million a year. One of the most influential figures in American broadcasting. Good God. Is that true? I suppose it is. Every time he writes one of his horrible books, immediate bestseller, but that's in part because they play with those big right-wing groups buy up thousands of those right-wingy books, which is why they're always at the top. Seriously. It's not like the average Joe on the street is beating down bookstore doors to get to them. Okay, so he also, he's been accused of lying in one of his books because he said he was actually at the scene when a CIA source who had allegedly been linked to the assassination of President John F. Kennedy, killed himself. So Bill O'Reilly was right there. He is starting to look more and more like Woody Allen to me in Zelig. Did you ever see the movie? Yeah, because Zelig was at every event. Or a little bit like Tom Hanks in Whatchamahookie. Can't think. Forrest Gump. All right, so here is I'm looking at a video of a younger O'Reilly reporting from the riots in Los Angeles. And this is when he was reporting for Inside Edition. And he has since told people that that period when he was out there reporting on the riots in L.A., quote, he told an online interviewer, they were throwing bricks and stones at us. Concrete was raining down on us. The cops saved our butts that time. And this week, earlier, he told another broadcaster, quote, we were attacked. We were attacked by protesters. Bricks were thrown at us. Okay, so let's go to Inside Edition colleagues at the time, many of whom were there at the scene with Bill O'Reilly. They include reporters Bonnie Strauss, Tony Cox, Rick Kirkham, crew members Teresa McEwen, Bob McCall, and Neil Anton. Not a one of them recalls any such incident. Kirkham, who was the show's lead reporter on the riots, is quoted as saying this: "It didn't happen. If it did, how come none of the rest of us remember it?" Here's what one of the people there, Neil Anton, said. I think he's referring to being at the intersection of Fairfax Avenue and Pico Boulevard. There was one person, one time, with one rock. Nobody was hit. A man came out of his house. He picked up a brick and threw it at a camera. There was no concrete. There was a single Brit. Oh, my God, says another one of the people told about this. This is a completely fictitious story. Nothing ever rained down on us. Apparently, what all the others say had really happened is O'Reilly had shown up at the scene like a prince. He had driven into this rubble-strewn riot area when people were trying to clean up. It was after the fact. He drove up in like a limo with a chauffeur and proceeded to order people around and make sure his shot was just right. And there was just something about him that bugged this one guy who was watching, who started screaming at them to get the hell out of there. So here's another eyewitness, one of Inside Edition's colleagues. So the guy was watching us and getting more and more angry. Bill was being Bill, complaining, "People are in my eye line," and kind of being insensitive to the situation. It was just so out of line. He starts barking commands about, "This is not good enough for me. This is not good. This isn't going to work. Who's in charge here?" And the man, whose neighborhood it was, started shouting at O'Reilly and the team. And O'Reilly said to him, "Shut up! Apparently you don't know who I am." That's according to two people who were there. And then, says McCowan, the guy just lost it. He picks up the brick or a piece of rubble and he tried to smash the camera. The producer restrained the man while O'Reilly continued to taunt him. While the producer, who is a good 12 inches shorter than Bill O'Reilly, was trying to fend off the angry man, with O'Reilly saying things like, "Come on, you want to take me? I'll take you on." Another witness said, named McCall, says, the producer really didn't have much trouble holding Bill back. It was a lot more show than anything else on Bill's part, which is typical, right? Bombastful, and letting some much smaller producer deal with the real threat. So a passing police car gets flagged down. An officer calls for backup, not knowing what's going on. Several more police eventually arrive. And crew members recall that before this, O'Reilly had been hauled inside one of the team's vehicles by a colleague. So he wasn't rescued by the police. He was rescued by his cohorts. The police were pissed, irritated, because they had bigger fish to fry than this bunch of nonsense. I, Here's another one of the people who was there. I don't have much respect for Bill, admittedly, having worked for him. He was a real jackass. Asked to respond to the claims from O'Reilly's former colleagues and to explain whether O'Reilly had been describing another incident when he said concrete had been raining down on us, a Fox News spokeswoman resent her original email statement, which I guess said, "We will not even deign to speak to respond to this." Declined to comment. Claims casting doubt on Bill's statements were nothing more than an orchestrated campaign by far-left advocates. Responding to the unproven accusation du jour has become an exercise in futility. Fox News maintains its staunch support of O'Reilly, who is no stranger to calculated onslaughts. Somebody should, you know, this is Fox News plays with an entirely different playbook. Entirely different playbook. Can you see NBC News getting away with that kind of thing when the same kind of, exactly the same kind of thing was happening with Brian Williams? Oh, God. Unbelievable. And actually, I think I said this yesterday, my guess is O'Reilly loves this. He loves it. So it's been found out that it's been found out he's a totally unreliable journalist. He makes things up. He makes himself a heroic figure going into war zones, witnessing events he was not at, and having concrete rain down on him, only having his butt saved by the police. No. But Roger Ailes and Fox News will double down and stick with their man. God, they must be the most cynical people in the world. They must not have a conscience. They must lie through their teeth so much that maybe they don't even know they are. Is that possible? Is it possible they really think that because Mother Jones or The Guardian are reporting this, ergo it is untrue? It is merely an attempt to defame them. It's mind-boggling. It's not worthy of discussion, is it? Why am I wasting my energy? Henry writes, if you've ever heard Bill O'Reilly on a talk show, he often is peddling his books. Yeah. I.e. Killing Lincoln, and then he wrote one Killing Jesus, and then he wrote one Killing Kennedy. He's got a theme going here, huh? He often paints himself as a historian. Please. And in fact, he was once a history teacher. Oy. God. So his tendency to embellish really makes you wonder if he's been rewriting history rather than reporting. You know, I got to tell you, the guy's a head case. The guy is, he is pure ego. He's pure ego and id. There's no superego apparent in him. There's no regulator. There's no internal editor. There is nothing but this big, huge, massive, blustering, bullying ego. And it's why his show is popular. I had to have that explained to me when he first came on the scene. I said, who the hell would blah, blah, blah? And it was explained to me by someone in the business that it's exactly what I hate about him that makes him so compelling to so many people. He puts on, I was told, a great show. You know, I've suppressed this, but I interviewed him once. I did. When I was at WPTT, seems to me in one of their changes where they would throw out a person who actually was a local who maybe had a show before mine or after mine or whatever, and instead put a syndicated show in for a little while, they had O'Reilly, is what I'm remembering, coming on our station, and to you know, give that some publicity, he was scheduled to be a guest on my show. And I've repressed it. I was in a pickle. I mean, that's in a pickle because I'm working for the, you know, what am I supposed to do? I couldn't outright rip him to death because, first of all, I didn't really know much about him. It wasn't like I watched Inside Edition. And I remember just being a wreck because, yeah. I hope I wasn't too much of a mealy mouth. Trying to watch her show, whose show? Unable, is Billy holding you hostage? Margaret, that don't make no sense. What are you talking about? What are you talking about?
Billy Nardozzi. I think he's making a joke.
Are you talking about Billy Nardozzi or Billy O'Reilly? What are you talking about? Don't send me cryptic messages while I'm trying to do a show. And be as bombastic as Bill O'Reilly so I'll be popular and be paid $40 million a year. Huh?
Start telling lies.
Start telling lies, my producer suggests. Seems to be a game plan that does work. It's a business model that is, you can't argue with success. That's what they say. So here's something weird. You hear this guy who was going to run for governor, the Republican, in the Republican primary at the state of Missouri, I like to call it. His name is Thomas Schweich. He killed himself. And bullet to the head at his home, right near my sister's house. And here's the weird thing about it. Just saying. He had just announced that he was going to run for governor, and then he blows his brains out. He had also just talked to a reporter at the St. Louis Post-Dispatch, the editorial page editor, actually. And he had talked to an Associated Press reporter. And he had made an appointment with them for them to come to his house at 2:30 that afternoon. He killed himself hours before that 2:30 appointment. He had already talked to one of the guys, I think the St. Louis Dispatch reporter, about he wanted to deal with a story. And here's what he said on his on the voicemail. Excuse me. He left a voicemail saying, "To me, this is more of a religion story than a politics story, but it's your choice on who the reporter would be." That voicemail was left just 7 minutes before someone called the police and said he... It's all so odd. But the St. Louis Post-Dispatch reporter says that the guy who killed himself, the guy who wanted to be the governor, had told him a few days earlier, and this is what the story was going to be, that the chairman of the Missouri Republican Party, one John Hancock by name, was spreading rumors that Mr. Schweich now deceased, was a Jew. And, you know, I read that. I'm reading this from the New York Times, and I'm thinking, wait a minute, you mean... There are so many levels on which I don't even understand. Okay, so you spread rumors that this guy, I mean, obviously John Hancock, the head of the Republican Party, is backing another Republican. And in order to hurt Schweich's chances, he, according to the deceased, was whispering to people that he was, Schweich, you know, is a Jew. Now, that's amazing to me, first of all, that that would be a way to hurt somebody in a major party these days. There are Jewish senators, Jewish congressmen, Jewish mayors, Jewish, come on. There's even a Jewish vice president of the, no, he wasn't, wanted to be.
aspiring Jew.
Yeah, an aspiring Jewish vice president. And according to the Post-Dispatch's reporter, Schweich told him, I'm an Episcopalian. And he said he thought that John Hancock was trying to harm his efforts to win in a Republican primary because when you're talking about Republican primary voters, you're talking about evangelical Christians. And evangelical Christians be much more inclined to vote for a fellow evangelical than some friggin' Jew who doesn't even recognize Jesus as our Christ. And our, yeah, Christ, I guess. So what does Christ mean? Christ means Savior, I think.
I think it doubles these days.
It doubles? I mean, it's not like his last name is Christ and his first name is Jesus. I mean, Christ was not a big... Jews do not believe Jesus was the Christ, I think is a correct statement. So, but why would he kill himself? How odd a story is this? You kill yourself because people are saying you're a Jew? That doesn't make any sense. And in fact, he'd already talked to a reporter about this is a weird story. Just saying. God. Ansel writes, I know you're done with Washington, but I think, see, you're paying attention, Ansel. I am not paying attention. Ansel, I'll find out things from you. I think it's fascinating that Mitch McConnell in the Senate sent John Boehner a clean Homeland Security funding bill, meaning that it just funds Homeland Security and it doesn't tack on something that eradicates the president's immigration directive. I think it's fascinating that McConnell and the Senate sent John Boehner a clean Homeland Security funding bill, and now Boehner is stalling because he apparently does, well, of course he doesn't have the votes to pass a clean bill. He's got a house full of yahoos, of ideologues, and a lot of those fresh-faced freshmen that all the smart American voters put in the house in the last November election, who know nothing about government. They only know they don't like it. And they especially don't like it when that Kenyan-born Muslim with a funny name is running it. So the Senate passed this bill 98-2. Wow. I didn't know that. See, I really don't know that. Even Ted Cruz, for God's sakes, voted for it. And Boehner, God, the House of House of Representatives, the lower house, never was that more apt. The lower house of our bicameral Congress. Let's face it, is not just dysfunctional, it's dysfunctional and dangerous. It is literally, it is the House, more certainly, more than the Senate, that is creating this disastrous charade of governance that we've got going on now. And it is the reason I can't even look anymore. I can't. I thought after they took both houses, I remember McConnell and Boehner, before I totally turned away, saying something that they were now going to show that since they controlled the Congress, that Republicans can govern. They're not just a bunch of obstreperous nitwits. Well, Boehner, I think your move. Ansel writes, imagine if the first big legislative standoff in the new GOP Congress ends with a stalemate between the two chambers rather than a stalemate between the Republicans and Obama. Well, as somebody said once, a house divided cannot stand amongst itself, cannot stand. And we got divisions everywhere we look. And there is no doubt the division within the Republican Party is pretty damn intense. And the division between the House and Senate is pretty amazing. Although the Senate's got a lot of these yahoos in there too, so I don't quite understand if Ted Cruz could vote for this bill, why can't some of these other idiots vote for it? Beyond me. It's beyond me. So, whatever. Stalemate is what they're all... They don't believe in government! So all the wannabes now, and hey, is it looking like my prediction is right? Hello? About Scott Walker? Hello? Scott Walker, ladies and gentlemen. Scott Walker, potentially our next president. God help us if that happens. I cannot say that with enough feeling. God help us. Oh. And I will be so guilty, although I don't vote in Wisconsin anymore, but I remember, I mean, feeling guilty that it was Wisconsin, my state, and even my neck of Wisconsin, that sent Senator Joe McCarthy to the Senate. And look at what he did to the country. Hello, caller.
Hey, Lynn, would you say the Pentagon's bloated, the whole military?
Probably, sure.
Too much?
Probably, yes. And
when we started this Homeland Security, wouldn't it have been smarter to take some of those troops and some of those personnel and put them in Homeland Security to save money? They're already working for the federal government.
I don't have any idea how things
are. I know they never do.
I don't know how things are structured.
They complicate everything. But.
But you could argue that the Department of Homeland Security was itself not the greatest idea. I don't know. We never had one before. I remember going nuts about even the name of it. I don't remember anyone ever calling America and this country our homeland. Homeland is what I think of what the Germans, the Nazis called Germany.
Oh.
Homeland is not something we ever said before. I swear we did not. I think if you go, so I freaked out about that. And then I freaked out about, oh yeah, that'll help us in this fight we're in. Another huge bureaucracy.
Yeah.
So we gathered a bunch of other dysfunctional bureaucracies and put them under the one heading, Homeland Security. And this is all in the overreaction, the fact that we were not willing to be careful and thoughtful in our reaction to 9/11. We had to act immediately. And so a lot of the stuff we did, obviously, not necessarily the smartest thing in the world. Of course, there's still a lot of bloat in probably, every time they try to pare the bloat away, I'm not sure they pare in the right places.
Yes.
They never pare at the top. They just throw little people out of work.
I can't get too excited about it shutting down. Yeah. I mean, other than the people getting laid off, I wouldn't want to see that, but I just don't think much of it anyway. So,
no, I understand. I mean, I'm starting to get there, too. Like, you know, it was Republicans who used to say, so what if the government shuts down? We'll be better off if it's not functioning. And now that they're essentially running things, I'm thinking, you know what? It's probably right.
Yep. Okay. We'll see you.
Yeah, bye.
Bye.
Oh, God. Let's stop talking about this. It's giving me a headache. Obit of the day. Oh, no. Break of the day. And then we'll talk about a dead person. Okay?
What if we woke up tomorrow and healthcare was suddenly simpler? What if doctors were rewarded for better results and patients with lower costs? What if tomorrow was already here? Because it is. With Highmark Blue Cross Blue Shield, rated number one for member service and plan satisfaction. For a better healthcare experience, you're better with Blue. Highmark Blue Cross Blue Shield is an independent licensee of the Blue Cross and Blue Shield Association, subject to the terms of your benefit plan.
Moments in Black History, brought to you by Highmark Blue Cross Blue Shield. Have a greater hand in your health.
The West African countries of Ghana, Mali, and Songhai used prisoners of war or convicted criminals as slaves. It was customary to sell these captives for profit or to trade them for goods. African slaves would work as all other workers and would not be subjected to heinous living conditions or other harsh treatment. One of the main differences between African slavery and European American slavery is that African slavery was not based on race. African slavery was similar to serfdom of the medieval times, where it was possible to elevate one's status to bridge the gap between slave and master.
BergBargains.com is your best bet for great deals. Check out the new and improved site for quicker access to deals and the best savings from the merchants you want. Log on today for discounted gift cards to TJ Maxx, Marshalls, and Rumfish. Pittsburgh's best bargains, BergBargains.com. Want something to do? Download the new and improved CP Haps app and find out what's going on in Pittsburgh. It's the free and fun app that puts the most popular events at your fingertips. Text events to 77948 to download now and register to win tickets to Britt Floyd at the Benedum Center. The CP Haps app, brought to you by Pittsburgh City Paper. Download now and get going!
You're listening to Lynn Cullen Live at pghcitypaper.com. Once again, here's Lynn Cullen.
All right, obit of the day. Here is a guy, the dead one, who was the last surviving member of what had been described as the oldest sibling group known in the world. Let's see. His sister, Lee, died in 2005 at the age of 101. She was the slacker. She was not the healthy one, apparently. Another sister, Helen, was 7 weeks shy of her 110th birthday. She died in 2011. The baby of the family, Peter, died last year after turning 103. The obit I'm sharing with you today is the last one of these siblings, Irving. And Irving just died, aged 109. Until late last year, he was still showing up at his Midtown office in Midtown to go to work. And he devoured newspapers and magazines literally until a few hours before he died. His son, or grandson, or great-great-great-great-great-grandson, was, a few hours before he died, reading to him, because he'd asked him to, an article from The Economist on Vladimir Putin. That's what probably did him in. Can you imagine the last things you're thinking about in your life? I mean, the last things that are that's going in to this long-lived brain is Vladimir Putin. Anyway, this guy's name is Irving Kahn, K-A-H-N, and he is the oldest, or was, the oldest active Wall Street investor. He had a investment firm, and he had it for over 8 decades. Jeez. What does it say here? His DNA and his siblings' DNA has been used by gerontologists and all kinds of people doing research on aging. And a lot of the studies said, according to one of the guys who'd been studying them, he said, look, that people like this that live this long, there's three variables. A mix of DNA. Gesundheit. Sorry, maybe you didn't hear that. Somebody sneezed. Mix of DNA. Healthy living. I always hate that one. And luck. You got nothing much. Healthy living is the only, of the three variables, that's the only one you have any say in, right? You can't pick your DNA, and you can't choose to be lucky. So, I'm thrilled to find out that Irving Kahn smoked until he was 50. So he was a long-term smoker, and according to his son, he never watched what he ate. I mean, he ate red meat. He ate anything he damn well pleased. So, according to the son, Irving Kahn lived to be 109 because he was blessed with great DNA and luck. Because the healthy living part didn't factor in at all. It's a lucky man. Unbelievable. It says he was a contrarian who made his first trade in 1929. Wish I had some of that DNA. Or some of the luck. Maybe I do. Okay, far be it for me to talk about these ISIS jerks, but they really are something, aren't they? They really are something. And finally, the New York Times did a piece of writing. I think it was, excerpted in the local rag, the Post-Gazette. But I love this because it is so true. This is by Anne Barnard, and she writes this. The reports are like something out of a distant era of ancient conquest, entire villages emptied of people, hundreds taken prisoner, others kept as slaves. The destruction of irreplaceable works of art, attacks on religious minorities, payable in gold. A rampage reminiscent of Tamerlane or Genghis Khan. I know some say Genghis Khan now, but I'm the old school Genghis Khan. And all that is true. But in reality, this is the MO of the Islamic State. And so you take that, kind of marauding, rampaging conquest that we thought was, you know, before people were civilized. We'd read about that kind of stuff in history books. It's depicted in art. But no, we're seeing it now, the year 2015. And then you add to it that some of the perpetrators are comfortable, Western, college-educated computer nerds. And all I could think, I've often said, and I'm now being proven absolutely right by these people. We, Homo sapiens, get on our high horse an awful lot. We the best, we the best. I mean, you talk about exceptionalism in America. What about Homo sapien exceptionalism? We think we're the cat's pajamas. And God help any species who ain't one of us. Unless we think you're cute and cuddly, then we'll be nice to you. We might even let you into our house. Otherwise, you're fucked. We'll eat you. We'll take your habitats. We'll destroy you. And we'll destroy your environment. And we'll destroy our own. But we're too stupid to realize it. Okay, so here's what I've been thinking. I often said, we are, I suspect, no different in any real way from our ancestors in prehistoric times. Because evolution doesn't work that fast. Homo sapiens has been here, blink, blink. And there's no way we are that different than Genghis Khan. I mean, no difference. It was the same thing. And I have said, have I not, that you can give a caveman a smartphone, but he's still a caveman. And ISIS, seems to me, is reminding us of who we are in a base manner. Here is Homo sapiens. It's not Homo sapiens in the year 204. No, it's Homo sapiens in 2015. Even Homo sapiens, as I've said, educated in the civilized West. Multilingual. Computer literate. Social media savvy. And look at the brutality. I think that we need to acknowledge ISIS are our brethren. We like to think they're something else. No, those are human beings. And look what they are still capable of. It's amazing. It's amazing. And when we say, we comfort ourselves by saying, well, they're evil. And I know I've said that too, because I can't comprehend them. But They're human, are they not? I think what's frightening about them is exactly, it's not what they do, but that they're capable of it. Because we look at them, and they look like us. They really do. They speak with clipped British accents. They are able to lure our children. I just think it's amazing. I really do. Hello.
Hi, Lynn. Hi. So, I've been thinking about this recently. I really do think that although ISIS appears under the guise of Islam, I think it's more of a world cultural phenomenon than an Islamic phenomenon.
And what is the how would you describe the phenomenon?
I think there is a direct relationship, and I've been trying to put focus on this because I want to do some art pieces about this, and the idea that this is kind of where our young people have come to in the 21st century. And the only reason I say young people is because they seem to be taking the old people, when culture fails older people, we just disappear or kill ourselves or something like that and don't take other people with us. But I think this phenomenon is really a world cultural phenomenon of the kind of the curtain being pulled back from, in large part, capitalism, in a huge part, capitalism, and the culture that we have developed surrounding it.
What? Where the? You know, but we used to say. I mean, that these. Okay, so if it's the result of capitalism, it's because the people. There are winners and there are losers, and then there are people who are left out, and then they get they feel humiliated and angry, and they don't have any outlets, and blah 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 blah. But from Mohammed Atta to this latest Jihad John or whatever the hell they're calling him, these people are. Part of the winning group. They're educated.
Well, no, I think that is just that they are educated. But I think in that education, and I think this is becoming mainstream. But I can give you a perfect example of where I see this in a culture that doesn't have the power, doesn't have the education, doesn't have, and I see it in the Inuit and the First Nation people of America, where. Their culture was ripped away from them. Everything they believed in was pulled out from underneath them. And, you know, they don't allow alcohol in Inuit villages in Alaska because they'll kill themselves.
It's poison to them.
I really think that the curtain has been pulled back from our culture that we've developed as a world. And people who have are seeing what's there, and they're saying there is nothing there. I think we have a world of we've turned into a world for the large part that are just nihilistic, and in large part again, I think it is that idea of capital. You either buy into it and work your ass off your whole life trying to get a better house, whatever, trying to get all those things that they sell you, or you say, man, this is all just a load of shit. And hand in hand with what you said about us being Homo sapiens, you know, the caveman with guns and weapons and technology, this is a byproduct of that for me. It is the violent version of going out and drinking yourself to death.
Well, it is. I mean, clearly at the heart of ISIS is a desire to destroy. I mean, to destroy everything. I mean, the destruction of these irreplaceable works of art, which they're now intent on doing, to provoke us. It's all about provocation. They want, I don't know what to,
I heard someone talk about that destruction of those, someone who I think probably know better than I do, talk about the destruction of that artwork. And they said this particular portion of that, of this the Islamic State. That is not for provocation. That is them rewriting history. That is them saying these were false gods that should have never existed. You should never have seen these. Therefore, they should not exist now. And you know, there's a huge hunk of eschatology here that's just destroying everything that has come before. And I think I really think it's a self-destructive thing, whether they acknowledge it or not.
But well, how do we? You know, I mean, the rest of the world that. We don't know how to fight them.
Well, that's the problem, is that when you boil it all down, the reason they are there is because what we offer people not to become this has failed.
Apparently, it failed. Obviously, no. I mean, there's still more people who are appalled by their actions than not.
But the solution that we give to people that are in this state, they've already turned their turn, because these are the mainstream, as you said, these are mainstream three young girls from England.
And usually, yeah, bright and, yeah.
Mainstream people who are looking at what they've been offered in life, and they're turning and
okay.
turning their backs.
But here's the other...
So therefore, we have nothing more to offer.
Okay, here's the other part before we get ourselves crazy here. We're talking about people in their teens and 20s.
Yeah.
Right? Now, I'll tell you, in my teens and 20s, I was lost. I was angry. I didn't know where I fit. I was bewildered. Not that I ever would have done something like this, but that is a period in which the being is not stabilized yet or mm-hmm. firmly molded. So they are, yeah, they're ripe for the picking. And but you'd be hard pressed to pull someone in their 40s, 50s, or 60s into this.
Sure.
Unless they were nuts.
Sure. And that's, you know, there's not that there are many reasons you couldn't. One is that we're just already worn out. One, we've thrown in the towel. We may be so, you know, we may have realized that, hey, listen, it's just not worth it. All those things, but you know, that the majority is the young kids that are doing this, and I think it's a cultural failure. And I mean, there's no rationalization. There's no rationalizing our way out of this. There's nothing to offer to get out of this.
Well, I can see if a young person, a sensitive young person, looking at the culture, our culture, as it presents itself, can find it rancid. Can find, right? Can,
yeah.
Yes.
I mean, in the movie Fight Club, there's a great quote in the movie Fight Club where he says, you know, we've been, basically, every young American has been promised that they're going to grow up to be a movie star and be rich and famous. And they've all realized they're not, and they're really pissed off.
Well, my anger at that period in my life was I also felt that I'd been sold a pack of lies. It didn't have to do with celebrity or that kind of thing. It had to do with what I was taught about who we were.
Mm-hmm.
Because I came of age during civil rights movement, during the Vietnam War. And all of these things, if you were sensitive, if you had your eyes open and were paying any attention, it didn't jive in any way with everything that had been poured into my head by all my teachers and parents and authority figures about what my country was, the hollowness of the words, all men are created equal, when I'm looking at the Walter Cronkite news and I'm seeing Americans, you know, beset upon by dogs and
sure.
fire hose. And this happened when I was a very impressionable young teenager.
Well, I didn't let go of that
anger for well over a decade.
Your generation went out and protested.
Yes, my generation went out and raised hell, and it
yes.
was because of
in,
that.
In the terms of what you guys thought was raising hell.
Yeah, what did we know?
There's a whole other hell being raised by ISIS, and it's
But see, there is that allure, and I, yeah, but I understand the allure.
I mean, I think there's no, in no small way, it is because culture looks back on those protests of the 60s and 70s and sees that not a whole hell of a lot has changed.
Well, come on. No, a whole hell of a lot did change. I'm going to fight you on that. I think my generation saw the most amazing liberations of whole and huge demographic groups, including women. I think the female, what happened to women in that period is just mind-blowing. We were released into the world in that period. That is huge, because we sort of saw it happening or were part of it and happened in a, and also you can't, I mean, African Americans, there's still a ton to do, but a lot was accomplished. And I might add, I don't think that the gay rights movement would have happened so quickly if they hadn't, you know, also seen how you create change, and if they weren't dealing with a country whose people had gone through so many social revolutions in such a short time.
I think it's huge. I agree with you on all that, and I agree with you on all of that. But I would say, what is the being given those, making those achievements, then allows you to do what?
Okay. Okay.
Part of the mainstream
of this America, mainstream horrific
work, make as much money as possible.
Okay. All right.
Get a new car.
Yeah.
Be as vapid as possible and die. In one way, that, you know, on a personal level, the civil rights have changed, but in the grand scheme, it's just
you're still seeing. You look out and you see a rancid culture. Not to put words in your mouth.
So on that note, we'll go into the week, into the weekend with a great outlook.
Okay, well, listen, perk up. It's a beautiful day. Goodbye.
I just started rereading Camus' The Myth of Sisyphus. So.
Well, there it is.
I'll see you.
Okay. Okay. Tim is asking, is our phone line down? You trying to call in and not getting there?
Phone line's definitely not down.
Not down, because I don't know. I don't know. Well, that was certainly a depressing hour, wasn't it? I had no intention of doing that to you. None. I'm sorry. All right. I think we're done. Have a great weekend. I guess I'll be on 4902 tonight if anybody wants to tune in. And I'll see you again on Monday. Okay. Toodaloo.
Lynn Cullen Live, Monday through Friday from 10 a.m. to 11 a.m. and archived at pghcitypaper.com. The opinions expressed on Lynn Cullen Live are those of the host and do not necessarily reflect the viewpoints of Pittsburgh City Paper, Steel City Media, and its advertisers.